Praise the Lord, Mount Carmel. We just want to give God praise this morning. Come on, our God's been real good to us. He deserves every praise. Come on, somebody just say hallelujah. Every prayer.
Welcome to worship here at Mount Carmel Baptist Church. We are so glad that you have decided to join us. We are excited, and we have a great worship service for you here today. So thank you for tuning in with us. Let us worship the Lord with our heart and with our mind. I was glad when they said unto me, come, let us go into the house of the Lord. God has been so good to us. Now is a time that we can pause to celebrate that goodness and all the things that he has done for us. Would you please go to prayer with me? God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for our uprising. We thank you for the blessings that we have already experienced, God. And God, it is at this time, right now, that we bring back to our remembrance all the things that have happened during the week, how you've guided our minds, our hearts, our bodies, how you've kept the enemy away from us, God. And for that, we come to give you glory. We come to worship you. We come to lift up your name. God, we come to you because you are the source. You are the one who has protected us and done all that you can do and the thing that you can do only by yourself, God. So we thank you. We thank you for our families that have been protected. We thank you for our children who have been to school and been protected, God. We thank you for our loved ones who have been out of the house around all of these things that we call a pandemic, God. We thank you for that protection. So God, stir up that gift in us, that gift of worship, where we celebrate that, God, and we don't take it for granted, but we lift our hands, we lift our minds, and we lift our hearts to you, God, because you are worthy of our praise. We ask you to be here in the midst of this service, wherever we are, God, listening on our devices, at home, on the job, wherever we are, God, that place becomes a place of worship. God, that you would bless that place and bless everywhere that we go so that those that we come in contact will know that we serve a God who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think, God. So we thank you right now. We give your name the glory, the honor, and the praise. It is in the matchless name of Jesus the Christ we pray. And everybody said, amen, amen. As I said earlier, if this is your first time worshiping with us, would you please place a 1 in the chat column so that we can take the time to welcome you to this worship service. We are so delighted that you have taken the time to stop by, and we want you to feel that warmth, to feel that love that we share here at Mount Carmel Baptist Church. So if this is your first time, place a 1 in the chat group so that we can acknowledge your presence and thank you for being here. And now it's time for us to go to our scripture. And today's scripture will come from Matthew, the 6th chapter. And we'll be reading verses 9 through 13. And I will be reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Matthew 6. 9 through 13, the word of God. Pray then in this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts, as we have also forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Mount Carmel, we are still worshiping. And we invite you, if you have the desire to come here and live and worship with us from the hours of 8 and 10:45, you can register to participate live on mcbaptist.org. So if that is your desire, we'd love to have you here. Please register. And now it's giving time. This is the time set aside for us to give back to God a portion of what he has given to us. We can't thank God enough, and we can't be to God what he has been to us, but we can be to that person who needs it. This community of faith that has been a pillar, not only to its members, but also to those who fall under the shadows of this building. So at this time, let us prepare ourselves to give. There are several ways in which you can give. You can give on Givelify. You can also go to our website and give at mcbaptist.org, and it'll prompt you through that. You can also choose to come by here Monday through Thursdays from the hours of 9 to 2:30. We close at 3, so let's be nice to the people who will leave at 3 and get here before that time. Also, on Wednesdays, we have extended hours from the hours of 3 to 6. So if you would like to deliver that in person and come by the campus, please feel free to do so. Mount Carmel, we have truly, truly, truly been blessed. And it is through our giving that we are able to bless others. So at this time, with that offering, let's go to God in prayer. God, we thank you for these gifts in advance. We thank you for what they mean to the kingdom of God. We thank you for the ability to be used by you, God, in service, to help those who are hungry, to clothe those who are naked. God, that these gifts that we give today will be used in a way that's pleasing unto your sight. God, there are some people who are going to give out of great abundance because they have truly been blessed by you and they have more than the average person. God, there are some people that are going to give out of great need. They're going to give expecting that window of heaven to open up and those blessings to be poured out upon them. So God, whatever situation the giver is in, God, we know that you can meet that. So right now we thank the giver and we bless the giver. And God, we also pray that this church will be the stewards that you have called us to be over these gifts, and that they will be used in a way that brings glory to your name. We thank you, we bless your name, and we give to the church out of love and out of sacrifice. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And now, Mount Carmel, let's continue to worship. Let's continue to lift up God and to worship him in song and in praise. So whatever space that you're in, I ask that you would make some room so that you can praise God in your own special way. That is you and God right there, that he is visiting with you because he's able to do that. And that you lift him up and that you praise him, for he is worthy to be praised. God bless you, Mount Carmel.
How many know Jesus is able? Come on, somebody say Jesus will. Yeah. Clap your hands.
Jesus will.
Yes, Lord. And when I'm in trouble,
Good morning, beloved, and welcome to worship. What a joy to welcome you today. I trust that you are well and having an outstanding Sunday morning. Let me thank our worship team for doing such an excellent job of helping to bring us into the presence of the Lord. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6. And begin reading at verse number 6 through 13. And there you find these words recorded. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we still ourselves in your presence, and we thank you for the privilege to share this word today. We pray it will be a blessing to all who receive it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Good morning, beloved. We're going to continue in our series this morning of the Lord's Prayer. Last week, we introduced this series and sermon, the first sermon, Our Father. And I challenge you to repeat the Lord's Prayer every day during the month of September, to read it out loud or to speak it out loud sometime during the day. How are you doing? Let me know in the chat. How are you doing? How did it go? Were you able to do that? Go ahead and give me a thumbs up. Go ahead and give me an amen. Say, yes, Pastor, I'm getting it done. And it is reviving. It is encouraging my spirit. Let's turn to today's message. Thy kingdom come. Your kingdom come. Set in the context of a time when Jesus' community began to take the gifted relationship, a loving relationship with God, for granted. A relationship between a loving father, a loving son, and beloved siblings or children. Jesus spoke these words which shocked the very foundation of the cosmic understanding of a relationship with God, the Creator. The human family, Adam and Eve, were created to reflect the glory of God and to establish the kingdom of God here on earth. And when those who followed Jesus' disciples asked him, Lord, teach us to pray. He said, when you pray, pray, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed or holy be your name. Thy kingdom come, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And that's where I want to pick up today in verse number 10. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus not simply accepted the rules of man's kingdom, and the followers of Jesus were not to simply accept the rules of man's kingdom, but they were being called to a higher standard. They were being called to become kingdom citizens. That's right, kingdom citizens. Somebody go ahead and type that in the chat line today. My meditation on Friday, I said, and many people affirmed, I'm a kingdom citizen. You are being called this morning to be a kingdom citizen. You're being called to raise up your standard. while you and I are citizens of the United States of America. Some listening may be a citizen of the United Kingdom, the UK, or some kingdom on the planet. We accept, and when we accept Jesus as Lord, we are accepting the rule of God into our lives. We are raising our standard. That's right, the standard is now the kingdom of God. The standard is higher than any man or woman's kingdom in this world. And today, God is calling you to a higher standard, to raise your standard. Somebody type that in for me. Raise your standard. Raise your standard. Look at what man's kingdom has been able to produce. Man's kingdom has produced violence and war. It's produced power grabbing and abuse. Man's kingdom has produced shortage of resources and poverty. See, in God's kingdom, there is no poverty. In God's kingdom, there is no shortage of resources. In God's kingdom, it is not necessary to try to grab power or to impose your will and abuse others. I was born in the Keystone State, Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania is known as the Keystone State. It's adopted from the old English Commonwealth. It's known as the Commonwealth State. And the meaning of being a Commonwealth State, there are four in America. A Commonwealth State means common good or common wealth for all its citizens. That's a beautiful vision, isn't it? That all the citizens would be able to have wealth and be able to do good. And that is what the kingdom of God reflects. See, the kingdom of God, in God's kingdom, all of God's citizens, all of God's children, they all have what they need. There's no poverty in the kingdom of God. There's no sickness in the kingdom of God. What did John say? John said, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them. And he will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away. Revelations 21, 1 through 4. And so in the kingdom of God, there is no abuse. There is no pain. There is no sorrow. There is no death. So when one resides in the kingdom, you're being called to a higher standard. Jesus sharing with his believers, the disciples, that they were to pray. But when they prayed, they were not to focus on men, but they were to focus on God. Their prayers were not to be directed to the crowds who would gather in the synagogues or on the street corners, or to be seen for the waxing of eloquence. No, Jesus said that they have their rewards. But when you pray, enter into your closet, that your Father, enter your closet and shut your door and pray to your Father in secret. Your Father, which sees in secret, will reward you openly. Somebody say amen. Somebody say amen. Aren't you glad this morning that you can talk to God no matter where you are at, and that your Father has big ears. That's right, big ears. That means he can hear you wherever you are. The point of Jesus' lesson is that God who hears you in private will reward you publicly. That God, when God hears your private prayers, that they produce public power. Let me say that again. Private prayer produces public power. Jesus says, when you pray, do not get caught up in vain repetition, as the heathens do. What was a heathen? A heathen was somebody who did not acknowledge that God, the God of the Bible, was God. A heathen was a pagan, an irreligious person, an uncultured person, an uncivilized person. A heathen was those who put their trust in their own power. Heathens put their trust in men. Heathens put their trust in the kingdom of men. They think that they shall be heard for their much speaking, but not you. But not you. Your Father knows the things you need even before you ask them. I love this, how it states in Matthew 6 and 25. Therefore, I say to you, do not be anxious for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, not yet for your body what you shall put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than raiment? Behold, the birds of the heavens, they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, and your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they are? And which of you, by being anxious, can add one cubit to your stature? Which of you, by being anxious concerning raiment, consider the lilies of the field, how they grow and do not toil, neither spin? Yet I say to you, even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God doth clothe them, and he clothes the grass of the field, now, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall not he much more clothe you? O ye of little faith, what shall we drink? Do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink? Wherewithal shall we be clothed? For all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of all of these things. God knows all of your needs. He made you. God created you. God shaped you. And so as a loving Father, God is disposed to provide all your needs. You are living in the commonwealth, in the kingdom of God. And as I said earlier, there is no poverty in the kingdom. There is no poverty in the commonwealth. And that's why Jesus says, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all of these things will be added to you. Be not anxious, therefore, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Suffice it unto the day of evil. Beloved, do not ever let your prayer life get reduced simply to things, more things. Your heavenly Father knows what you are in need of, even before you ask them. And so he says, seek the kingdom of God. Seek that the kingdom will come into your life. Seek that the kingdom will reside in your heart and in your mind and in your soul. Seek that the presence of God and the kingdom of God and the will of God will be done. And when you do that, all of those things are already included. God knows you need a house. God knows you need to get around. God knows you need cars. God knows you need food on the table. And so when you seek God, God has a way of providing for all your needs. That's what David meant when he said, "The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not walk, what shall not want. I am living in the kingdom." These simple verses, concise and short, stirs our heart, designed to transform our lives. They are not complicated. They are intentionally designed so that if you are at a fifth grade or fourth grade or third grade or sixth grade level, no matter if you've had a lot of education or no education, they are ordered so that you can connect with the kingdom of God. Beloved, do not overcomplicate your relationship with God. I've been blessed. I've been privileged. I've been to several schools. I've cultivated a vocabulary. I've practiced on a regular basis speaking before people. But none of that is necessary to have a loving relationship with God. All of that is simply a gift that was extended to me. A loving relationship with God has nothing to do with your stature in life, has nothing to do with your education accomplishments, your professional accomplishments, does not have anything to do with your vocabulary. No, a loving relationship with God is simply that you have accepted the kingdom into your life. Remember that acronym, KISS, Keep It Simple, Stupid, came from the U.S. Navy in the 60s. The KISS principle stated that most systems work best when they are kept simple rather than complicated. Therefore, simplicity should be the key goal in all design. Keep it simple. Keep It Simple got rebirthed in 1970. In the 70s, and variations began to pop up. People would say things like, "Keep it simple, silly." "Keep it short and simple." "Keep it simple and straightforward." "Keep it small and simple." "Keep it simple, soldier." "Keep it simple, sailor." "Keep it sweet and simple." Somebody saying, "I hope this sermon is sweet and simple." Go ahead, throw somebody a kiss and tell them, "Keep it simple. Keep it simple, sweetie. That's all you have to do." Go ahead and type it in. I like that better. "Keep it simple, sweetie." Keep it simple. Don't complicate the kingdom. God has already worked it out. The ministry of Jesus was simply this. Yes, he healed. Yes, he cast out demons. Yes, he set the oppressed free. Yes, he elevated the status of women. But it's clear from Luke 44 and 44, he said, "I must preach the kingdom of God to other cities. Therefore, I am sent." And he preached in the synagogue and of Galilee. In other words, he came for the distinct purpose to preach the kingdom, to usher in the kingdom. "Thy kingdom come." When Jesus came, he brought with him the doorway to the kingdom. When John the Baptist was baptizing and preaching in the wilderness, John had a sermon. It was a great sermon, but he had one sermon. His sermon was, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." And beloved, the kingdom of God is right here with us today. And so Jesus ushers in the kingdom. Jesus reveals the kingdom. What is the kingdom? The kingdom is the Father. The Father is the King. Every kingdom has a king. The Father is the King. And the kingdom is the kingdom of heaven. And the King is Supreme King. He's Yahweh. He's King of kings. As a matter of fact, the Bible says his son Jesus. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord. So today, if he's your king, type it in. Type it in. He's king. He's king of kings. Every kingdom has a king. And the kingdom of heaven, or the kingdom of God, is ruled by a king. That king is Yahweh. He has an intention. He has a plan. It is his intention to spread the kingdom. The kingdom is a spiritual kingdom. It's an invisible kingdom. It's a kingdom that he invades the world with. In other words, when God created Adam, God had a plan. When God created the world, God had a plan. God created the world, and then he put Adam and Eve in the world. And when he did that, they were to reflect the glory of God. That's right. They were to reflect the glory of God. And just like Adam and Eve were to reflect the glory of God, the world was to reflect the glory of the kingdom, so that the kingdom that on earth would reflect the glory of God in heaven, so that earth would look like heaven and heaven would look like earth. Somebody missed that. You got to get that, because what we have is marred creation. We have scarred creation. We have never seen the creation as God intended, because with the fall, when Adam and Eve made a choice to create their own kingdom and not follow the kingdom of God, from that point on, it was then a marred world. The soil, God did not curse Adam and Eve, but he did curse the ground. The soil has never produced as it would have if it was reflecting the glory of God. But God is so wonderful. God is so good. God would not cast Adam and Eve away. God would not cast God's creation away. And so what God did was God initiated a plan. And that plan was simply this, that what Adam and Eve broke, God was going to put back together. What Adam and Eve cast away, God was going to bring home. When Adam and Eve set up their own kingdom, God said, your kingdom and every other kingdom after that will be subject to my kingdom. And God set up a beachhead. God set up camp. God set up a foothold, and it was designed to usher in the kingdom. And for thousands of years, man believed that he could create a great kingdom, so much so that even Babel tried to knock on heaven's door. But God said, you cannot knock on heaven's door, because I'm God and you're Babel. You're confused. Your human creation. You have to understand that my kingdom will rule over every kingdom. And so God sent prophets. God sent teachers. God sent kings and wise people to try to help the people to understand that God was King of kings and Lord of lords. And they continued to push his kingdom away and push his kingdom away. And they built their own kingdoms and continued to try to marshal their own power so that they believed that they could not be touched and their kingdoms would never fall. And you've heard the old saying that kingdoms rise and kingdoms fall. Nations rise and nations fall. And we've seen it time and time again throughout history. But what God did, God said, no, I've got a plan and I'm going to work my plan out. And so God sent a forerunner. His name was John the Baptist. He was like a prophet of old, like Elijah. And when he came, he said, "Behold, the time is at hand. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." And folks started coming one by one to this barefooted prophet standing in the River Jordan, having come out of the desert, eating locusts and wild honey, wrapped with animal skins. He stood in the river, and there he baptized. And he said, "I baptize you in the kingdom, that today you can be in the kingdom. And today, my brothers, today, my sisters, I give you a great opportunity to be in the kingdom of God." One day over yonder's hill, a barefooted carpenter named Jesus came down the hill, having gone through the wilderness, now stands in line. And when he gets to John the Baptist, John looks at him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. Behold, the Lamb of God. I'm not worthy to tie his sandals." The record records, "The heavens opened, and a voice said, 'This is my beloved Son.' The Spirit descends upon him like a dove." And Jesus is baptized, symbolic that he is in the kingdom. I'm talking to somebody today, that he has accepted the kingdom of God into his life. And when he came up out of the water, he was off on a mission. And what was that mission? That mission was to preach. That mission was to teach. That mission was to walk. That mission was to heal and to cast out the demon. That mission was simply to live out the kingdom of God, so that heaven had come to earth, and now earth would be able to go to heaven. Let me say it again. Heaven had come to earth, and earth would be able to go to heaven. And that's exactly what we have today. We have a little bit of heaven on earth. Let me say it again. We have a little bit of heaven on earth. Pastor, how does it work? The kingdom is within you. It starts like a little seed, like leaven in a bread, until it causes the whole loaf of bread to rise. And that's what God does. That's what the Spirit does. That's what the Holy Ghost does. It's leaven in your heart, in your life, and it causes you to rise. And when you rise, as somebody said, "This world can no longer afford me a home. I've raised my standard. I'm getting higher and higher." I like that old song that Marvin Winans took and started singing. "I want to be ready. I want to be ready when Jesus comes. I want to be ready. I want to walk into Jerusalem. I want to walk like John. I want to be ready." What does that mean? I want to be in harmony with God. I want to be in peace with God. I want to walk such that when heaven comes in my life, that heaven has taken up residency. It's invaded my heart and my mind and my soul. I want the kingdom to live inside of me. That's what Jesus said, Luke 17, "For the kingdom of God is within you." 17 and 20, go ahead and read it for yourself. The kingdom has come. It's not making a whole lot of noise. It doesn't have with it a great band. It doesn't carry a marching band. It doesn't have trumpets and horns announcing its arrival like the Roman leader. No, the kingdom comes in silently. It comes in quiet. It comes in unseen. It's leaven at work in a batch of dough. Jesus said the kingdom has already begun. The Pharisees did not understand it. God was ruling in the hearts of the people as they came one by one by one. And that's what's happening today. God is ruling in the hearts and the minds of God's people as they come one by one by one into the kingdom. And when you walk in the kingdom, it's a spiritual realm. It means that somebody can look at you and say, I don't see any change. Nothing happened. And you say, honey, just keep watching me. Just keep your eye on me. When they look at you and they say, where are you from? Don't simply say, I'm from Pennsylvania. I'm from this city or that city or this state or that state. I'm from North Carolina or South Carolina or Georgia. No, honey, you tell them I'm from heaven because I'm a kingdom citizen. I've come from heaven and I'm on my way back to heaven and I'm in heaven now because I'm in the kingdom of God. It is no breaking from the kingdom, in the kingdom, going to the kingdom. That's how God intends for us to live. The kingdom has arrived. The kingdom is here. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And somebody said, well, why do we have such problems, Pastor? Because the kingdom is partial. It has not come to full consummation. So that we live in the kingdom, it's partial. We have a foretaste. We have a foretaste. We have a touch of it. We have a hint of it. But one day soon, and very soon, we're going to see the King. And every kingdom of this world must bow to the kingdoms of the world to come. Let me close with this short fable. Some of us are familiar with it. And if you're not, let me give you a quick update. For those who have difficulty dealing with change, big or small change, there was a compelling book that came out some years ago. It was called Who Moved My Cheese? It's a fable about four characters who lived in a maze, and all they loved was cheese. When the cheese disappeared, these four characters, they were mice, scurry, sniff, headed out into the maze to find the cheese. But scurry and sniff, enthusiastically in the midst of the change, went to find new cheese. On the other hand, him and Hall felt betrayed and simply complained. Scurry and Sniff went searching to find new cheese. Him and Hall felt betrayed and complained. They wasted their time and energy hoping that the old cheese would return. Hall realized after some time the old cheese wouldn't return. So he set out into the maze in search of new cheese. What he learns in the process and is hoping for is that him would follow him. And so as he discovers new ways, he tries to leave signs for him to follow. He discovers new cheese. And when he discovers the new cheese, he sees that Scurry and Sniff were already there. You recognize that the cheese is a metaphor. It's a metaphor for whatever you want in life. It could be a good job, a loving relationship, money, or health. The very core of the message of the book is simply that things constantly change and we must learn to adapt. And the quicker we adapt to change, the more satisfied we'll be with it. The book reminds us that we need to accept that change happens, that there is some change that's beyond our control, and that we need to find the strength to be able to adapt. And it's a good read, having sold over 20 million copies, and yet it has some great lessons that you can apply and adapt to those who are going through change. And yet the message is incomplete. In short, the message is incomplete because life is more than simply running through the maze. Life is more than simply designed for us to be mice running and chasing after cheese. No. Life is more than that. God made you. And when God made you, he made you for a greater purpose than simply to sniff after cheese. But so many people are trapped in the maze today. So many people are just running, scurrying, sniffing. Others are hemming and hauling and complaining about their journey. But I came to tell somebody today that God offers a whole different plan. That's the plan for man's kingdom. Man builds the maze. Man builds the maze, and he throws a small piece of cheese in the maze every now and then. And if you're not careful, you'll get caught up in the game. You'll think you're being successful. You think your life purpose, your work has meaning. But after a while, you'll find that there's no escaping the maze, that there's somebody outside the maze who has set up the maze so that they are always benefiting, and you are always losing. The problem becomes this. The problem is not simply that the mouse is in the maze, but the problem becomes when the maze gets in the mouse. Let me try that again. The problem is not simply that the mouse is in the maze, but the problem becomes when the maze gets in the mouse. And that's what happens with the kingdoms of this world. The kingdom of man gets inside of man, and then he's got a problem. He's trapped. He can't get out. He can't find his way. He's constantly bumping into wall after wall after wall. But Jesus reminds us, let this mind, that's what Paul says in Romans, let this mind be in you, that in Christ Jesus, that you can be renewed by the transforming of your mind, so that you will learn to stop simply running in search of the cheese. But after a while, you'll stand back and you'll look up. Oh, my God. And when you look up, you'll see that there's something that's above the maze. What's above the maze is the sun that shines. Somebody said the S-U-N that's shining. And yes, it's above the maze. But above the S-U-N is the S-O-N that is shining. He's Lord of lords and King of kings. And if you learn to look up, somebody type it in for me. Look up, somebody type it in for me. Lift your head, type it in. Raise your standard, type it in. Move out of the maze, come out of the kingdom of man and come to the kingdom of God. How do I do this? Sometimes you got to work together and help each other out of the maze. Sometimes you got to leap over the wall, help you get out the maze. But if you really want to know how to do it, what you have to do is change your thinking, change your mind, change your vision, change your approach. And what you see is that when you get in the maze, all of a sudden you will be transformed like the Holy Spirit. And you will be able, when you come to a wall, to simply walk through the wall. That's what Jesus did, you know. He walked through the wall. The very thing that's holding you back, he walked through the wall. He showed up in a transformed body. He walked through the wall. And that's why you can change your life. Because when you start living in the kingdom, you get a new walk and you get a new talk. You get a new way of speaking and a new way of acting. You get a new way of eating and a new way of dressing. You get a new way of treating each other. Somebody come on and help me. Give God glory and give God praise. You are a kingdom citizen. You can come up. You can look up. You can come out. Tell somebody, I'm coming out today. I'm coming out today. No more poverty, no more sickness, no more pain, no more death. The kingdom has arrived. I'm living in the kingdom. Jesus died so that I could live. He died on the cross so that I could live. He was buried in a tomb so that I could live. And on the third day morning, he got up with all power in his hands so that I could live. And if anybody asks you what's going on, just say he reigns. He reigns. He reigns forever and ever and ever. He reigns forever. Hey, him. Hey, sniff. Hey, scurry. Guess what? You can come out the maze, honey. You don't have to live your whole life, your whole existence, following somebody else's program, following after somebody else, trying to get what somebody else has said you can have, and that's it. No, no, no. Guess what? Look up. There's a kingdom above you that God has come down to. And when you look up and you go through the transformation that God has for you, oh my goodness, even if nobody else will help you come out the maze, and there are many people who will help you come out the maze, guess what? You'll be able to walk through the walls of the maze. And when you're on the outside, you won't run back to the maze because the maze will not be in you. The kingdom of God will be in you. I'm praying for those who've been in the maze so long that the kingdom is in them, the maze is in them. And the problem is, even when you take them out of the maze, because the maze is in them, they scurry, they sniff, they hem and haw their way back, because it's all they know. It's all they want. It's all they can ever be, because they're not willing to accept the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Beloved, accept him and accept the kingdom in which he brings with him. Today, you can start living in the kingdom. If you have not accepted Christ Jesus as your personal Savior, I want to give you a great invitation. It's an invitation of faith to say yes to God. And today, you won't see the change on the outside yet, but you will see, feel it, and know it on the inside, and day by day, it will grow inside of you. Pray this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I accept you as my personal Savior. I thank you for dying on the cross for me, and I give my life to you. Come, come live in me. I accept the kingdom of God as my reality, and I shall walk in it every day of my life. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I want you to thank God for the gift of salvation, the gift of the kingdom of God in your life. You are on a great journey. Believers, come on and thank God today. You're on a great journey. You're on a great journey. And every day, there's so many who are hearing me right now. You can give testimony to what I've said and what I'm saying right now, that you are living right now in the kingdom of God. You may never make it to be CEO, but you are a child of God. You may never get that promotion, somebody hanging it over your head, but you are a child of God, honey. You may never get that raise they keep promising you, one day jump through this hoop, do this one day. You may never get that big church. You may never get that, be a part of the professional team you're trying to be a part of. But guess what? It's okay. Because you are a part of the kingdom of God. And what God has for you is for you. All right, beloved, thank you for joining us today. And remember, every day during the month of September, we're repeating the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I got a word for you next week. I'm looking to walk through this series with you. So come on, call up a friend, tell them to join us. If you haven't subscribed, go ahead and hit that subscribe button so you make sure you know that we're on and you can connect with us. Love you in the Lord. Hi, I'm Casey Kimbrough. If nobody told you today, I need to tell you, I love you, I love you, I love you. God loves you. God loves you. And remember that you are somebody important because you are a child of God. Peace and grace. Have a beautiful day. And Lord willing, I will see you same time, same way on next Sunday morning. Thank you for making Mount Carmel your church of choice.